You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Bio 190. My name is Kira Mathis, and I am your instructor. Hopefully, everybody knows that by now. Today, we have Deanne with us, who we'll go to in just a few moments. She is our expert on our pelagic and deep seas, which is all about today's session. Normally, we go live to the aquarium, but we are not going to be able to do that today. We were having some technical difficulties. Sometimes that happens where we can't quite connect, so they were not able to see and hear us, and that would not make for a fun interaction. So we're going to try again next week for you. But today we are, as I said, talking about pelagic and deep seas. But before we get into that, I want to go over just a few things with you. Today's chapters for reading are chapters 15 through 17, 69, and 70. So make sure you read the chapters in our lovely coloring book that has lots of great information. That'll give you lots of information about today's topics. Reminder, our field trip paper is due October 21st at the end of the day, so at 11:59 p.m. Make sure you give yourself a few extra minutes to turn that in so there's no glitches. I would suggest uploading at 11:45 just to be safe. If you have arranged or your sponsor has arranged a different due date, that is fine. That means that you don't have to worry about the October 21st date. However, if you have not talked to me or your sponsor has not talked to me about an extension or about moving it up or whatever it might be, your due date is October 21st. Our research proposal is also up. We're going to be talking about that again, in about 2 more weeks. I'll give you a little bit more details on that. Right now, I want you focusing on that field trip paper, unless you have that extension on the field trip paper and you want to start looking at that research proposal. Research proposal is due November 21st, again, at 11:59 p.m. I suggest making sure to turn that in before then, just to be safe. We have been working on discussion boards. I've been getting some great emails, people asking for feedback. Those are in the process of being graded, so at least your first and most of your seconds should be graded now, so you can get some feedback. If you have any questions or concerns, of course, please email me, and we can discuss those and then give you lots of feedback. Each week for your participation points, I'm getting lots of great questions. Obviously, I will not be able to answer all those questions. I go through those questions. I kind of compile some that are similar, and then I usually address them in the following week's lecture. However, if there's something that you are just dying to know and I have not been able to get back to you on Blackboard, please email me those questions. So the whole idea is just participation. I want you guys thinking and interacting. However, know that I will not be able to answer all 130 email questions each single week, but I will try and answer some of them here on the air for you. All right, so with that, we will be introducing Deanne now. Don't forget, if you have any questions today, don't forget your participation points. You can call in, you can email in. We love to hear from you. The participation has been great. We'll get you those points. You can earn up to 2 points per week. And with that, we'll now introduce Deanne. So Deanne and I have been working together for quite a while, and she's gonna tell us a little bit about how she got here, and then we'll jump into today's topic. So Deanne, it's all you.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here and help out with the class today. My name is Deanne, and I'm an aquarist, someone who takes care of the fish and invertebrates at the Aquarium of the Pacific. How did I get the job? Well, as I was going to college, I started volunteering at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and in the husbandry animal care part, but also in the education part as well. And then as I was volunteering, I was networking, learning about the jobs, and then, of course, got hired on when I got that degree.
So you have a degree in marine biology?
Correct.
Awesome. And how long have you been at the aquarium?
Over 10 years.
Oh my gosh. I've only been there 7. I'll have my 7-year anniversary next month. So you got me beat. Deanne and I used to work in the education department, but now part of her job is working in the Wonders of the Deep Gallery, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
And that's where we were going to go live from today. But just real quick, since we didn't get to go live, can you tell me a little bit about what our Wonders of the Deep Gallery is like?
So with the Wonders of the Deep Gallery, we basically are focusing on different types of habitats you will find in a deep sea environment. So today you're going to learn about some of those types of habitats. One would be like a whale fall exhibit. There's also a bioluminescence exhibit, and there's a hydrothermic vent exhibit. So we're just basically portraying the organisms that will be in that type of habitat.
And we'll learn kind of what the hard parts of living in those types of ecosystems are as we move through the day. Now, today's topic is pelagic and deep seas. So the pelagic seas aren't necessarily the deep seas. It's more just like the open ocean. So we're going to start with that, and then we'll work our way down into the deep sea for our second portion of today's lecture. So pelagic waters, how would we describe pelagic waters, Deanne?
Well, pelagic water is of course, lots of water. I mean, most of our ocean is actually pelagic. If you are out in the pelagic water, one of the things, there'll be no navigation sites everywhere, anywhere. There'll be, like, no landmarks. So it'd be very difficult to navigate in that type of an area. Also, there'll be no structures to use as to hide under or to rest upon. You have those currents and those waves that are... make it to be a very choppy environment. So, of course, moving throughout that environment would be really difficult.
Yeah, I just kind of imagine open ocean, mm-hmm. right? Like no land around you. There's nothing to hide. It's just open ocean with not much, just water.
Yeah.
That's how, just water, right? So basically a three-dimensional environment amplified in ocean where there is no bottom in sight. So again, we're only going to be talking about kind of this top portion here in the first portion, and then the second half of today's class will be that really, really low portion. So how would we define where a pelagic sea starts? What would you say?
I would say that it would start, it'd be the volume of seawater that would be pretty much extends from the coastline. And there'll be different zones that will...
that we'll look at, right?
Yes.
So we actually have a great image. If we can pull up the ocean zonation image, this will help kind of break these zones down for us. Can we take this full screen, please? There we go. So we've got this top portion up here, right? And this is actually a pretty important zone. And we call this the epipelagic zone, also known as the photic zone, right? Would you agree? Yeah, photic zone.
Yes.
And then we've got this kind of middle group here. This is the mesopelagic or middle pelagic, right? Middle. And then bathypelagic is this section here. So if you look over here, we're talking at 1,000 meters at this point. So bathypelagic, 1,000 meters. And then way down here, we've got the abyssal pelagic, which we're talking about 4,000 meters. And then way down here, they call this the hadal pelagic, kind of like Hades, which is the god of the underworld, right? Hades. And we're talking about Mariana's Trench there, which is one of the it's like the deepest place in the ocean. It's 11,000 meters. That's an insane depth. So when we talk about stuff, though, today when we're talking about our pelagic zone, we're mostly going to be talking about the epipelagic zone here in the first part of the lecture, and then we'll be talking more about this in the second part of the lecture. So just kind of to give you an idea there. And that photic zone we're going to talk about, too, quite a bit, is really, really important. It's the uppermost part, but that's also where most life lives, right, up to about 650 feet. So that's basically what we're going to be talking about when we talk about that epipelagic zone. Let's talk about the types of organisms that live there. There's basically two types, right?
There's two types. There would be the plankton, which is the plant bacteria form of the plankton, which is pretty much the base of the food chain.
And then there's also the zooplankton, which we'll get into. And then there's the nekton. And nekton, like, I think this is kind of a nice way to break it. We have like plankton, and then we've got nekton. How would you describe nekton?
A nekton will be plankton or organisms that basically can swim against a current.
Right. So plankton being you cannot swim against a current.
Yes.
And nekton being you can swim against a current. So, for example, let's take a look at a jelly here. A lot of times, you know, we hear the word jellyfish or sea jellies. We've talked about this a little bit before. Last week was actually Cnidarian Day, or we were talking about coral reefs, rather. And these are, even though they can be really big, they're still considered plankton, right?
Yes.
Why?
For one is basically they can't swim against a current. They pretty much drift in the ocean.
So if, for example, you were to imagine plankton, I think oftentimes people think of plankton as microscopic. Like, oh, we need to look in a microscope and we see all the little things that are floating around, but that's not necessarily the case. You can still see it. If it can't swim against a strong current, you're considered plankton. Does that mean that we're considered plankton?
No. We actually can swim.
I don't know. Have you ever thought about, like, against a strong current? I don't know. Could we? I don't know.
Well, I guess you can. You can get really hurt, I guess, if you're
riptides, out of riptides. Right? I don't know. So maybe we are a little planktonic. We have a question from Julia. What percent of our seas are pelagic? I don't know how to answer that. I mean, I guess most, right? Like,
well, if you think about it, if you look at the world map, you have your coastline. I mean, I would say that just a bare minimum of that ocean is covering those coastlines.
Right.
And then the rest of the map is ocean. So I don't know the exact percent.
But a lot of it?
But I would say a lot of it.
I'd say a lot's fair. So, all right, Julia, thank you for being our first person to write in today. Don't forget, you can email in questions or call the number there at the bottom of the screen for your 2 participation points. If you call them, we always love calls. All right, and moving on, we have a nice picture of Nekton, just some examples of Nekton, or animals that can swim against a strong current. So if we can pull that up full screen right away. There we go. So we've got like a huge variety of things here. We've got squid, and we've got dolphins and sharks. Oh, squid and sharks and dolphins. Fish, lots of different types of fish. We've got the anglerfish here. So lots of really cool different animals, lots of varieties that are able to swim in those currents. So now that we kind of understand the 2 types of organisms we're going to be discussing, let's jump into plankton and learn a little bit more about plankton specifically. So you already mentioned there's 2 types of plankton. We have phytoplankton. Those are photosynthetic, right?
Yes.
So that means that they are photosynthesizing?
They are, yes. And they're producing that oxygen as well.
Yeah, like a plant.
Pretty much.
Like a plant. So they're going to take in carbon dioxide. They're going to be their own food producers. And one of the byproducts of that is oxygen. Now, people always, I brought this up before, but people always think that a lot of our oxygen comes from trees.
Not so much. Actually, most of it comes from our ocean.
Yeah, at least half of it. So we want to make sure that our plankton are doing really well. They are the base of the food chain. And then I always joke like, oh, if you come home and your hair's all sticky or your ears are sticky or whatever, it's because you took a bunch of plankton home with you. So it's not going to hurt you, right?
No.
No. We have a call. Let's go to the call real quick. Who do we have on the line with us today? I thought it was going to be you, Katie. Hi, Katie.
Hi.
Hi, what's your question for us today?
I was wondering what gives Nekton the ability to swim against the current?
That's a great question. So what gives Nekton the ability to swim against a strong current? It's going to be their body structure. If you think about all the animals that we just showed, they pretty much all have tails and fins that are going to enable them to swim, or some kind of jet propulsion. Think about the squid. So the squid, which we'll learn about on Cephalopod Day, take in water that go over their gills, and then they shoot it out a siphon, and that's really propelling them forward. So they're having some kind of energy dispersion that's able to push them forward. Usually it's a tail, but in the case of like squid and octopuses, those kinds of things, there's going to be some other kind of jet propulsion that gets them. If you think about all the plankton or little animals that can't swim against current, jellies, they don't really have anything to move them too much around the water. If you think about a jelly that pulsates, for example, there's no real jet propulsion there versus a squid or an octopus. So, all right. Thanks, Katie. Any other questions?
No, that's it. Thank you.
Awesome. All right. We'll put you in for your 2 points today. Thank you for calling.
Great.
We also have Jennifer. What layer of the ocean is referred to as the deep seas? It's pretty much anything past that epipelagic zone. So when we get into mesopelagic, you start to get into the deep seas. And then for sure, the bathypelagic, the hadopelagic, those are all going to be considered deep sea. What part of the ocean do giant squids and deep sea animals live in? That's going to also be the deep sea, Ashley. So it's going to be the same idea that they're going to be in those deeper parts, usually not the epipelagic, although sometimes they will come up to that photic zone / epipelagic zone. Do you know how far down the giant squid go?
Oh, thousands
yeah,
of feet.
Really far.
Really far.
So yeah, so they're going to be in those like meso and bathypelagics. So, all right, so back to that phytoplankton, the plant-like plankton. So they are the ones that are photosynthesizing. And that's also, if you think about it, right, photosynthesis or photosynthetic animals have to be in that photic zone. Photic zone being the top, right?
Yes.
And that has to do with sunlight, because the sunlight can't penetrate all the way deep down into the ocean. So because phytoplankton is the base of that food web, it's got to be where light penetrates, hence the photic zone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we got another call, I think. Who do we have on the line with us today? Dominique, I knew you were going to be second today. I got you guys down. All right, Dominique, what's your question?
Why is plankton the base of the food chain?
Well, it's got to start with somewhere, right? So how else would you imagine it starting? For example, like how would you imagine the littlest thing or the smallest thing driving everything? Like, is there anything that you could think of that would be a better starter for a food chain? Are you there?
Hello?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Yeah, I was just asking, is there anything that you could think of that would be a better starter for a food chain?
I don't even know.
Right? Like, I mean, the whole thing is that you start with something that can produce its own food. And what can produce its own food is phytoplankton. And because phytoplankton produces its own food, it doesn't rely on a lot of other things to survive. And then you have the animals that then rely on the phytoplankton to start you, like the zooplankton, and then off your food web goes. So.
Right.
All right. Thanks, Dominique. We'll put you down for your points.
Thank you.
All right, and Elizabeth, how big can giant squid get exactly, and how long do they live? Great questions. I actually don't know. How big do giant squid?
You know what? I don't know.
We'll look it up.
We will look it up. I mean, they get pretty large. I mean, that's why they're called giant squid.
But we're talking 12 feet, right?
Something I would say that? 12 to 20 feet.
Yeah.
I would say they get pretty large. And
not much is known about them, though, right?
Much is known about them. And, of course, with an animal getting that large, you definitely are going to live a little bit longer per se. An animal that's smaller might live a short amount of time. So, yeah, I don't know if they even know how long they even live for.
Yeah, I know that there's only been a handful that have been studied. Usually it's like Humboldt squid, for example, which are small. They're still a huge squid, but they're smaller than the giant squid. So who knows? Yeah. Hale, what types of plants, if any, could be found in the ocean, in the open ocean and deep seas? So that brings up a good question. Speaking of ocean plants, right, one of the things that you said, Deanne, is that there's nothing for them to hold on to.
Correct. So basically they'll be floating out in the open ocean. So of course there wouldn't be really any way for them to rest upon any rocks or anything like that.
Same thing with the deep sea. If you're in the deep sea, there's no photosynthesis, so you're not really going to have any of those plants out there. It's all going to be a kind of a different sustaining environment, which we're actually going to talk about when we get into some of the challenges of deep sea living. Paris, are there marine fungi? Yes. I don't know what they are, but I mean, like, we hear about, it's going to be coastal, right? It's not going to be
what we're talking about today, of course.
Right, well, but I don't know of any
pelagic.
I don't know, like fungus on the bottom. I don't know. I mean, I'm thinking about like tide pools, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I don't know what would live on animals. We'd have to look that one up too. What are predators against phytoplankton? We just hit on that. It talks about how it starts with the food web. Lots of things, anything that are going to be eating microscopic plant-like organisms. And Jennifer, when we go too high in the air or too deep in the water, our ears pop or have a lot of pressure. Do deep sea animals experience things like this, or do they have natural preventions against it? Great question, Jennifer. We're going to circle back to that when we get to deep sea. Right now, we're going to focus on the pelagic, specifically the epipelagic, which is up on the top there. All right, so moving on, we'll talk about zooplankton a little bit. And zooplankton are animal plankton. So they're the ones that are essentially feeding on those phytoplankton, right?
Yes.
And anything special about zooplankton that makes them different?
They're basically the animal plankton.
Right.
They eat the photoplankton, and then, of course, other animals will eat the zooplankton. And that's kind of where the food chain starts with, is the phytoplankton going down from there. And what's nice about the photoplankton is that, of course, they can't move against the current, so they're easy to catch. And so that's why they are the start of the food chain.
Yep. Abby has a great question. Of all the pelagic water zones, is there one that is more populated by animals than the others? And that actually wraps up a great point. 90% of life in the ocean can be found there. So right up in that top photic zone. So the photic zone and the epipelagic are essentially the same. If we're talking about the different zones of the ocean, we're going to call it epipelagic just as far as depth per se. But living the photic zone, which is just the light zone, which is the epipelagic zone essentially, is where 90% of the life in the ocean are found. So perfect. You were literally on the next point we were just going to make. We have a really cool video that kind of highlights plankton that we're going to go to here in just a second. It's a little bit more, it's about a minute and a half. So we'll watch this and it'll just kind of really, I think, bring home how awesome plankton is. And then we'll move on to nectin shortly after that. So if we can go to our video of plankton.
Seen from space, the blue Earth is unquestionably an ocean planet. Standing at the shore, the ocean looks endless and empty. But below the surface, the ocean is actually brimming with microscopic plants called phytoplankton.
If you were to take an empty Coke can and go scoop up some water from the shore, in the Coke can you would have between order 75 to 100 million phytoplankton in that Coke can.
This invisible forest of phytoplankton is critical to life on Earth. Phytoplankton provide the base of the marine food web. They also help our planet breathe. Through photosynthesis, phytoplankton generate one half of the oxygen produced on Earth that all animals, including humans, need to breathe. The blooms of phytoplankton also take carbon dioxide out of the surface waters, making the ocean an important carbon sink. Like plants on land, phytoplankton need sunlight, water, and nutrients to grow. They thrive in surface waters where the sun's rays reach, and their nutrients come from many places. Cold waters carry essential nutrients from the ocean's lower depths to the hungry surface plants. The trillions of phytoplankton in the ocean are critical to study. But how do researchers track these invisible drifters?
All right, there we are, we're back. I was just catching Deanne up on some of the stuff that we've done. So she was asking how many sessions that we've done this, and I was saying, this is our fourth one for the year. So we had, actually, Perry's your boss, right?
He is, yes.
Yeah. So Perry, who was here on our first day, is Deanne's boss, so I was letting her know that Perry was here too. So, all right, so that's kind of a cool video there that shows how it works, how that upwelling works. Again, we talked about currents on Oceanography Day, how that really ties it in together all the way back to plankton. I can't emphasize enough how important plankton is in the oceans, both for the animals that live there, our oxygen, and the overall balance. All right, one last thing before we move on to the nectin. We talked a lot about phytoplankton, photosynthesis. Let's talk about those zooplankton a little bit. There are essentially two different types of zoo or animal plankton, right?
Yes, the two different types. One is holoplankton, and that basically is plankton that pretty much lives planktonically for their whole lives. So they don't need to rely on another organism to grow on or to live with.
So for example, like a copepod.
Yes.
Right, a copepod is going to stay plankton its entire life. I think we had a picture of the copepod. Let me see. Do we have that one? I thought we did. We might not. So anyway, a copepod, we've shown them numerous times before. They are one that when they're born, they're plankton. When they die, they're plankton. They're plankton their entire life, which is a little bit different than the marrow plankton, right?
Yes. So they, of course, are born planktonic, but then they grow up to become another type of animal, such as a fish or an invert, like a crab or an octopus.
So when a crab is born,
yes.
Or hatches from the egg, rather, it's little teeny tiny,
mm-hmm.
It's going to drift with the water.
Yes.
And then as it develops,
it will pretty much settle to what you'll see as an adult
crab.
And
those don't get drifted, like those don't get pulled away by current, so they're no longer considered plankton.
No. Right. Basically, they'll be just settling on the bottom, moving around. I mean, of course, crabs can swim,
yeah.
But not in that planktonic stage when they were first born.
So let's take a look, actually, then, at a baby crab or a crab zoea, a little thing here. We have some cool pictures. Can we go full screen on these? I think we have a couple pictures, actually. So that makes sense. That does not look like anything that could swim against the current.
Oh, no. I mean, if you look at it, it's super small. It's under a microscope. There'd be no way that that animal, due to its body weight, can swim against a current.
Can we show the other picture? I think there's another picture. Yep, there's some little ones there. So again, just perfect examples of animals that are not going to be able to swim against that current. And then we have a great visual of the crab life cycle. Can we pull that up? We'll go straight into full. There we go, full screen with that. So we've got that little hatchling, the zoea, there. And then they're going to slowly start to move this way till we get like the juvenile crab, adult crab that then lay the egg. So right around this area, they're good. They're not plankton anymore. They can hold on. They can swim against currents. They're totally good to go. And then the life cycle starts again. But this guy up here, plankton. And even here, the megalopa, what is it? Megalopa, I think is what it is, right?
Yes.
Those are going to be planktonic too. So it kind of gives you an idea of those animals that are able to switch from plankton as they get older into non-planktonic animals. We've got a couple questions here. Let's see, we already answered Abby's. And Jamie, are octopus and squid the same family? Yes, we'll be talking about that on Cephalopod Day. Are sunlight, water, and nutrients all phytoplankton needs to survive? Yeah, basically. I mean, they're going to need currents. They're going to need nutrients, obviously, is the important part. There can't be an overabundance of nutrients. One of the things that they have to be careful of is if plankton are like, plankton can get bleached out. Have you ever had a plant that's been in the sun for too long and it almost turns like a yellow color? It's like too much sun. Mm-hmm. Plankton can have that too. So if they're not able to regulate a little bit in that top zone, they could get bleached out if they're right on the surface. Hail, after I heard of a possibility of the first case of Ebola in Texas, I thought of it if there are any viruses that affect marine animals. Yes, there are lots of viruses that affect marine animals, and we're not going to get into those today. But yeah, there are quite a few. One, we talked about the wasting disease of sea stars. They think that's a virus, right?
I believe so. I think there's lots of conclusions of what it could be. But we've seen it a little bit from just some of the animals that we've collected with certain species of sea stars. And of course, we do collect sea stars from other areas that we've seen this wasting disease. We definitely don't want it to affect our local waters due to that disease.
Absolutely. Paris, so the crab life cycle is similar to that of a frog. Yeah, basically, I mean, frogs start out as little tadpoles mm-hmm. and they're little swimming things that probably would be considered plankton. I don't think they could swim against a strong current if they were ocean going. Obviously they're not, but yeah, same idea that they're gonna do this transformation into the adult version looks much different than the little larval or little baby version, yeah. Julia, how long does it take for the plankton to turn into a full-grown crab, so the zoea? Oh, that's a good question. I think it obviously depends on the species. Are you familiar with any of the things that we've done before, how long it
takes? You know what, I wouldn't know. I mean, colder water organisms, of course, will take a much longer time due to the slower metabolism. More warmer waters, of course, would be shorter time.
Julia, ask that question again when we do Arthropod Day. We're going to have Sandy here with us, and she's actually done some crab studies, and we're going to be talking about crabs again, so she's going to be the perfect person to ask that. So think about that question in a couple of weeks. All right, so let's move on and talk about nekton now, so those swimming organisms in the epipelagic / photic zone. And we're just going to touch on a couple, like, extreme cases here and important things too, just to share some fun stuff of what's in the ocean. Small fish are pretty important, right?
Oh, yes.
So when we think about like bait balls, for example, why are bait balls so important?
Bait balls are important because they feed larger predators, even us, of course, as humans, we do feed on fish. When you have a shark out there, you have the bait ball that's sticking together because, of course, that shark's nearby. And the reason why they do that is because they look larger. They don't want to be preyed upon by that predator, that shark. Of course, you'll have stragglers that come out of that bait ball, and they may become prey to that predator.
Yeah, I was going to say, you might be wondering what a bait ball is. We just started mentioning bait ball, right? But we didn't really talk about it. Bait balls are small fish. So herring, anchovies, capelin, lots of small fish that will bundle or school together And they do that, as Deanne said, to try and look bigger than they actually are. But it becomes a pretty great feeding ground for lots of animals. Like you were saying, sharks, they find these bait balls. They're going to be going after those stragglers that are kind of on the outside. If you're in a bait ball, all you have to do is not be the fish on the outside. You just got to be the fish on the inside where you're nice and protected by everybody else. We have a really cool video of a bait ball feeding frenzy going on. But if you think about it, think about the food chain. Obviously, it's more like a web. But if you think about the chain, we start with phytoplankton, zooplankton. Other plankton are feeding on those plankton. Small fish are feeding on those plankton. So we need lots of fish. Those smaller fish are going to be playing a huge role in the larger predators' diet and so far up the food web. That's why these smaller types of fish, like these herring bait balls, play a vital role in being the food for lots of other animals. So if we can go to that video, this is a cool video. I like this one. This would be a go. It's about two.
At such times, hunters gather in astonishing numbers. Bonito, smaller relatives of the tuna. They're searching for still smaller plankton feeders that have been attracted by the bloom. So are these jacks, and their prey is nearby. A school of anchoveta has strayed up near the surface, even though it's broad daylight and hunters are on the prowl. These small fish can already feel the vibrations of the approaching predators. Swimming at speed, they formed into a ball, and now they must wait for whatever comes. They've been detected. At first, the sheer scale of the bait ball seems to daunt the predators. But now the bonito arrive and launch the first attack. Still the bait ball holds together. The young yellowfin tuna move in. The speed of this attack is so great that gradually groups of anchoveta are splintered from the main fish ball.
Such all of that video. I think it's so cool. So it gives you an idea of the importance of the bait ball, and then after the tuna come the sharks or bigger fish, and then the sharks, and then the dolphins. I mean, we see dolphins out on our whale watching boats all the time feeding on these bait balls. And when they're at the surface, which we kind of saw, we'll call it a boil, like a fish boil, just because it looks like the water is boiling. But just goes to show that those small schooling fish play a huge role in the overall health and food chain that happens off in our oceans.
And it's just not marine animals, it's actually birds as well. So it's amazing to watch. Just everyone just
huge feeding frenzy.
Feeding on those fish.
Yeah, definitely. All right, so we're gonna move on now. So that gives you an idea of kind of the small fish. Let's jump to like the biggest fish. We'll go from like these small little fish to like the biggest, the whale shark. What can you tell me about the whale shark?
Well, the largest fish in the ocean, I mean, they're truly amazing. I'm 50 to 60 feet. And that's a pretty long fish. You're probably wondering, gosh, that fish might eat big fish just because it's a huge fish.
Yeah.
But actually it doesn't. It actually eats plankton, which is pretty amazing.
I guess it kind of makes sense. Animals that are typically really big usually eat lower in the food web. And that has to do with trophic level. So that basically means that there's more energy available from the food that you eat if it's lower in the food web. And that's something that they're really, really good at doing. Let's real quick jump to some questions. So Jennifer, so are bait balls like the group of fish that guide Marlin and Dory to Sydney in Finding Nemo? I've never seen it. Don't be mad at me. But Deanne can answer that.
Yes. Those are bait balls, especially when they form those pictures of other animals and I think had happy face.
Yeah.
Well, of course, those bait balls out in the ocean don't do that, but of course, in Finding Nemo, they do.
You gotta have a little Disney flair.
You gotta have
right? a little Disney flair. Julia, do you know how many fish on average are in a bait ball, or is it just too varied to calculate? I think it's too varied to calculate. I would say easily in the thousands, but again, it's gonna depend on where you're at, what kind of fish it is, our multiple bait balls coming together. So yeah, it's gonna be a little bit too much to vary, but I would say definitely in the thousands. Now, you said that they eat using, or plankton, right? They're mm-hmm. gonna be eating plankton. They don't really have teeth. Obviously, teeth don't really help you when you're eating microscopic animals, right?
No, so they have rakers, where basically they open their mouths, you see the picture right here, and they basically just open their mouths really wide and then they rake that food in that's found at the surface of the water.
On the gills, a lot of times they'll call them gill rakers. They're like little hooks or like little fingers that are right next to the gills, and those will help like kind of filter out the food out of the water. Now, we don't really ever see whale sharks here, right?
No. No, you typically find them much more, I believe, warmer waters.
Yeah, you're going to find them down in the warmer waters. However, there was a whale shark spotted off of Catalina Island 3 weeks ago.
Oh, that's amazing. It's probably because of the warm temperatures.
Yeah,
that
we've been having extremely warm sea surface temperatures, which we talked about. I showed you that really cool visual. But yeah, we actually had a whale shark a couple weeks ago. But normally you have to go down to southern tropical waters. You can actually swim with whale sharks in Belize. That's one place that I know a lot of people like to go. I, however, have a video I want to show you. It's not swimming with a whale shark, but it's this idea of gill rakers. It has to do with manta rays, which are related to sharks. They're a ray, so they're a type of flat shark. We'll talk about that on Shark and Ray Day. But I went to Hawaii in February with one of my coworkers, Julian, who will be here on Marine Mammal Day with us. And we did this manta ray dive, and these manta rays are huge, and they're also filter feeding using gill rakers. So you'll be able to see lots of plankton in the water. This is the GoPro footage that I took when I was snorkeling there. GoPros are awesome. Anyway, so I want to show you this clip. I think we picked out like 2 minutes of it or something like that, just so you can see, but this is me. And then the big arm you see on the left of the video is my coworker, Julian. We can give her lots of crap about that when she's here in a couple weeks. But anyway, if we can go to that, that would be awesome. So really cool. So these, again, are the manta rays. Again, they're not whale sharks, but the whole point is that they have gill rakers similar to a whale shark. And when this whale, or when this guy comes up, I think we were going to start it in the middle. Can we fast forward to, I think we had a minute mark pulled up where you can really see the gill rakers. You can see the plankton in the water floating there. That's better, yeah. We want to get a good look at the gills there. So you'll see these guys flip around. All those little dots are all the plankton. You can see the gills inside the mouth there, no teeth. But by letting that water filter in and over their gills are able to collect all that plankton, and that's what they're eating. The light is what's attracting those plankton to the surface. Now this is zooplankton. They're feeding mostly on zooplankton. Little belly rub there. Now, we weren't in danger at all. They're not trying to hurt us. They're just feeding. They have rubbed bellies with many, many snorkelers before. And then we ended up getting a second one in there that joined as well. So it was kind of fun to see. All right, so we can bring it back now. Kind of cool, right? So if you ever get to Hawaii, I definitely suggest a manta ray snorkel or dive. Super cool.
So were you diving or snorkeling?
We were snorkeling, but we did have divers below us. It's more expensive to dive, so we decided to snorkel. But yeah, it's super cool either way. So the scuba divers are down on the bottom, and they're looking up and watching all this feeding, but we're actually there, and the lights are on our little floaters. That's why there's all the plankton there, and then they just start circling. And
so you're doing this at night?
At night.
Oh, wow.
Super cool. Got to do it. I totally recommend it. Amy, how many fish are average in a bait ball? Again, kind of hard to calculate, but definitely in the thousands. And are the whale sharks friendly to us humans and other marine life? Yes, they're very docile to the point where many people have gotten in the water with them and have swam right next to them. Paris, what happens if a small fish gets stuck in a whale shark's, while it's feeding, I'm assuming its mouth or its gill?
I don't know.
It'd probably...
probably become food.
Yeah. I mean, they could swallow it. Yeah. It's not going to not swallow it. But or it just gets stuck and it eventually wiggles out or dies or... I don't know. We'll have to put a camera in there. Abby, do whale sharks eat strictly plankton or do they ever eat large animals? Do not eat large animals. They're going to be eating plankton because that's where they can get the most nutrients from, which is allows them to get that big. If you think about our largest land animal, do you know what it is?
Largest land animal. I know much about marine animals, but large animals.
Elephant.
Elephant, okay.
Elephant. African elephant. What do they eat?
Veggies.
Plants.
Plants.
So animals that get really, really big often eat lower in the food web. So, all right, the next one that we'll talk about is the ocean sunfish, or the mola mola. I love them, don't you?
Oh, yes. They are pretty cool looking, that's for sure. They get pretty big.
Yeah, they're the biggest bony fish.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so whale shark is the biggest fish, but they're cartilaginous fish. We'll talk about that on fish day.
Mm-hmm.
But mola molas are the biggest bony fish.
Biggest bony fish. They get 10 to 13 feet. And they weigh over 4,000 pounds.
Hello.
Pretty big. And if you ever go whale watching or if you're out in the open ocean, you can actually see them at the surface laying on their sides, which is really neat to see.
Like a flat pancake. So this guy's upright right now. So like he's upright right here. But what happens is he goes up to the surface, lays on his side. So all of this is exposed, floating on the top of the ocean. And then animals will come eat things off of him, right? Like get parasites off of him. Birds and such. So they're up on their side just hanging out. And it's kind of cool to watch because they're usually a deeper diving fish and they love to eat jellies. That's one of their favorite foods. So they have this little mouth right here. Just that little thing there slurps up some jellies.
So they have to definitely come up to the surface for one, to get rid of those parasites, and then two, of course, to eat, to find those jellies to prey upon.
So yeah, really, really cool fish. They're called mola molas or ocean, mola mola is the genus species name, and then ocean sunfish is the common name. So Amy, where are the best snorkeling spots in California? Funny you should ask. There are so many. Catalina is a great place to go snorkel. We have places. There's kelp forests all around here. We go down to San Diego. There are some great places in La Jolla. We have, what is it, Abalone Cove?
Abalone Cove.
Abalone Cove, I think, is a pretty good place to go snorkel. Anywhere that you can have kelp forests, which is Dana Point.
Laguna Beach.
Laguna Beach is really nice. Palos Verdes. All up and down the coast, there's tons of great places. It just depends on what you can easily get access to. But Catalina, if you can catch a boat over to Catalina, they have almost like little reserves, marine protected areas, and then dive sites that you can get in where that's where people just go there to snorkel and dive. So beautiful, beautiful place. Lots of kelp forests. And you don't have to go to places like Hawaii to see cool animals. You won't see manta rays because they're warm water, but you could see other rays, bat rays, leopard sharks, lots of cool things like that. All right, the last one we're going to look at that is oftentimes a pelagic open ocean animal are sharks. We see lots of sharks out there, right?
We do, yes.
Anyone in particular that you like?
Oh, man. I'd say that I like them all. I mean, they're pretty cool, misunderstood animals, but they are definitely up on the top of the food chain.
Yes.
When we talk about the food chain.
So they're going to be feeding on both large and small animals, depending on the species, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so here we have a blue shark. And the blue shark is just an example of an open ocean shark. Are there any hints that this guy dives deep?
Any hints that they dive deep? Well, they have those really large eyes.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too.
That could be an adaptation for an animal living in the deep sea.
Yeah, the blue shark here, it says, can travel throughout the open ocean. They're found to go around 3,740 miles in just 16 months and known to dive as deep as 1,640 feet. So that's pretty impressive. They also have this thing called counter shading, which we're going to talk about. It's the way they're a little bit darker on top and lighter on the bottom. We'll talk about that on our fish day as well. There's lots of open ocean sharks, though. One of my favorite is the great white. Mm-hmm. I actually saw great white last summer. So awesome. We've had this summer, because it's been extra warm the last couple of months, we've had hammerheads out here. Mm-hmm. Last year I saw a great white preying on a sea lion. That was pretty cool. We've had some juvenile great white sharks. We see blue sharks, mako sharks, thresher sharks, really cool animals. So, and again, when we're whale watching, we're going out, you know, to these deeper water areas and trenches. So lots to see for sure. All right, with that, it's 3:45 on the dot. We're like right in the middle of the class. We're gonna actually take our break. So we'll take our 5-minute break, and when we come back, we'll jump into deep sea. Lots of great participation, guys. We're gonna do our mystery item when we get back for people that are watching live as an extra opportunity to write into us. And with that, if you need to, get a drink of water, stretch your legs, and we'll be back in about 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. To want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. So hopefully you had a good break. Deanne definitely did. That's why she's feeling a little frisky right now. So we're going to jump right into our mystery item.
What's wrong?
We're going to jump right into our mystery item today. Again, this is for people that are watching live. If you're watching live, you can guess the mystery item. If you are not watching this live, there will be a question of the day for you. And if you need an extra point, you can also answer the question of the day. But the mystery item is for people watching live right now. So let's bring that photo up. Now, Deanne, don't give this away.
Oh, I know it.
So if you think you know what this is, please write in or call and let us know. And of course, you'll get your points for it. Kind of interesting. I like this one. This has got some significance to it. I like it. All right. So if you think you know what that is, there's something different about you, Deanne.
I know, huh?
All right, so if you think you know what it is, let us know. With that, we will go ahead, while we're waiting for you to think hard about that, jump into deep sea now. So deep sea, again, is that hadal pelagic area. Jennifer's already got it in. Is it a sea snail shell? Good guess, not quite. They're in the same phylum. I'll give you that. So we're talking about the abyssal, some of the mesopelagic, the abyssal pelagic, batty pelagic, and even the hadal pelagic zones of the deep sea now. And there are lots of things that animals and organisms that live in these deeper waters have to overcome, right?
Yes.
Like what kinds of things?
Well, for one, it's super cold. It's like 4 degrees Celsius.
That's freezing.
That's
really cold.
Really cold. So that's one thing that they would have to battle. Other things would be high pressure. That's another thing that they would be having to battle as well.
And someone had that, I'm sorry, don't remember who it was, it had the question earlier about the pressure, the ears popping. This is that perfect example. Imagine this for a second. If you were to put an empty 5-gallon bucket on your head, that wouldn't hurt, right? I mean, you have a bucket on your head, no big deal. Fill that bucket with water, and you're going to feel a lot of pressure on the top of your head. That's with 5 gallons of water. Imagine going down thousands of feet and all that water that's essentially sitting on top of you. So animals that live way deep in the water, they have all this pressure on them, but they're essentially adapted to that pressure. What would happen if we were to bring one of those pressurized animals up to the surface?
Well, if it's a fish, their swim bladder will, of course, expand, even come out of their mouth. So, of course, that would not be healthy for a fish like that. So when you do have to collect deep sea fish, there are certain measures that you have to take when doing so.
You have to keep it pressurized, essentially,
correct,
right?
Correct, yes.
So that's kind of like if you were to take, I mean, we live at a certain pressure. So if you were to take us, like our body is adapted to have all this stuff pushing on us, and that's kind of what helps us stay together, is that we are adapted and live at this pressure. If you were to start releasing pressure and there wasn't a lot of pressure on us, like we could just start to like expand, our skin would start to expand because there's nothing kind of pushing our skin together. And that's what happens with those deep sea animals is they're used to, they rely on that pressure to essentially keep them together, just like we do. But if they were start to come up and there's less pressure and less pressure and less pressure and less pressure, their body starts to expand. Yes. And then...
And if you ever go scuba diving, you'll actually feel that as you're going down, down deep. Because right now we have one atmosphere pressure on us, but then when you go down to 30 feet, then that's two atmospheres of pressure. So you'll definitely hear your ears popping while you're diving deep.
And that's only, I mean, we were just talking about this today, that the longest scuba diving record was just beat a couple of weeks ago, we think. I was in the news, I think. I'm almost positive of it. And it was like 1,000 feet, right?
1,000 feet. I believe it was in the Red Sea.
Yeah, and so imagine that, 1,000 feet. We're talking about thousands of feet.
And this is a scuba diver that's actually in scuba gear.
Yeah, that went, and there's obviously special measures that have to be met. But that's only 1,000 feet. I mean, we're barely past the epipelagic zone in this, and we're talking about all those other zones that get way down there. Mm-hmm. We had a couple guesses come in. Can we go back up to the top just so I make sure I get the first person in, right? Amy, is it a conch shell type of snail? No, good guess. Hail, the shell seems to belong to maybe a sea snail, and that was indeed a fancy mustache.
Thank you.
Thanks, Hail. It's actually not a type of sea snail. They're related to sea snails, but it's not a sea snail. Paris, is it a nautilus shell? Deanne?
You are right.
So you are correct. It is, in fact, a nautilus shell. Do we have a picture of a nautilus, please? Can we pull that up? Maybe, hopefully. Maybe not. If not, I have the cross-section here. So you were essentially looking at the inside of a shell. This is what the outside looks like. This is what a full nautilus shell looks like. And so you can see, there we go. So you can see it's got the opening here. It's just like a big shell. But there's an animal that lives in here. Now, oftentimes this looks like a snail shell, but it's not a snail, right, Dan?
It's not, no. It's actually related to, it's a cephalopod. It's related to an octopus and a squid.
Yeah, an octopus and squid belong to the phylum Mollusca, which we're going to be talking about in a couple of weeks. Now, if I were to cut this shell in half, that brings up this cross-section, and this cross-section is what you were looking at for the mystery item today. Now, this is really, really interesting, which now brings up our question of the day. This is called a chambered nautilus, and they've got these chambers in there, hence chambered nautilus. I want to know why they have these chambers. So look up that answer for an extra point. Do not tell me today. You're going to go under the participation tab. This is especially for people that are not watching live. However, if you need your second point today or even your first point, you haven't gotten any yet, make sure under participation that you tell me the question of the day. No more answers for mystery items, so you guys have gotten those. But yeah, the chambered nautilus, a really, really cool animal. We actually have some at the aquarium in the Wonders of the Deep Gallery that we were supposed to look at today. So if you make it to the aquarium, make sure you stop in and take a look. Now, speaking of our question of the day, I do want to encourage everybody to look up those answers. I'm giving you a hint about something to look up those answers. I don't know, you guys might have a quiz that opens up today that might have some of those previous questions on there. That was a good hint, right?
That was very good.
So, okay. All right, so moving on to the deep sea stuff. Okay, so we said it's cold, high pressure, high salinity, lots of dissolved compounds in these lower areas. So salinity is slightly less than 35 parts per thousand. But actually, let's go back to the high pressure. I want to talk about hydrothermal vents. We have a hydrothermal vent exhibit at the aquarium, but hydrothermal vents are really something special, right? Can you go over that with me, Deanne, what those are?
Well, you see the picture here. You have the hydrothermic vents, and at the bottom of the seafloor, you have the Earth's crust, and it cracks open, and then we have that really cold water, and then you have that sulfide methane oozing out, and with the touching of the cold water and those chemicals will create the smoking that you see that's coming out of that that crust there.
These are essentially called usually like black smokers, right?
Correct, yes.
Yeah, so this looks white here, but oftentimes it's actually kind of a dark color. Mm-hmm. It also looks like black smoke coming out. So we've got, like you said, cold water that creeps down into the cracks of Earth's crust. It's heated to the high temperatures, and then it comes out through these vents that mix with the hydrogen sulfide and the minerals. They crystallize when they hit the cold water, and we get these black smokers.
Yes, and it's actually really hot.
Hot. Very hot.
Very
right?
hot. I would say 700 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah. How come it's not boiling, do you know?
I'm sure it's probably just the combination of the cold water and the chemicals.
And the pressure.
And
right?
the pressure, of course.
Yeah, the pressure. So I always like to say, you know, we do a lab at the aquarium that talks about pressure. And there's, like I said, we always say there's pressure on us right now. Well, when you go to boil water, you have to boil water at 100 degrees Celsius. Why isn't it 99.5? Why isn't it 1,000? Why is it 100 degrees specifically? And the reason for that is because that's the amount of heat and energy it takes to overcome pressure at sea level. So at 100 degrees Celsius, the water has overcome the pressure and is now boiling and overdoing the air pressure that's on top of it. So if you go up in the mountains, you know, I don't know if you think about this, right? If you go up in the mountains, is there more pressure, less pressure?
Less pressure, I would say
right?
less.
Yeah, because you're going up. So does that mean it's easier to boil or harder to boil?
If it's less pressure, I would say it's probably easier.
So you can boil actually at a, you bake shorter yeah. periods of time. Your water boils quicker. So just an idea that that kind of works when you have less pressure. So if you have more pressure, it has to be so hot that it's overcoming the pressure. But 700 degrees is not hot enough to overcome the pressure of thousands of cubic feet of water on you, so or on the hydrothermal vent. So 700 degree water, and it's that's Fahrenheit, right? 340 degrees Celsius, and it's not boiling. So kind of cool.
And all what's right. amazing is they just discovered these too.
Yeah, this is somewhat of a recent find, so we didn't really know a ton about them. There's a really cool video on hydrothermal vents I want us to take a look at. So if we can go to that video, you'll get an idea. We actually have like live smokers going, and there's really unique communities that live on these hydrothermal vents. Now, if you think about it, there's no photosynthesis. There's no start of the food chain down there, but yet there is a whole ecosystem on these hydrothermal vents. And I think this video will help us to figure out why. So if we can go to the video, that would be awesome.
Clouds of sulfides solidify into towering chimneys as tall as a three-story house. At 400 degrees, this scalding cocktail of chemicals would be lethally toxic to most forms of life. But astoundingly, a particular kind of bacteria thrives here. And feeding on the bacteria, vast numbers of shrimps. So, beyond the farthest reach of the sun's power, a rich, independent community exists that draws all its energy directly from the Earth's molten core. One and a half miles down, at a site known as Nine North, towering chimneys support a spectacular display of giant tube worms. These vents give off so much energy that some of the worms reach 3 meters in length. They're the fastest growing marine invertebrates known. All told, over 50 different species have so far been found living here. The inhabitants of these bustling communities may grow at speed, but their existence can also be short, for the vents do not erupt indefinitely. Suddenly, unpredictably, they may become inactive.
All right. right. So super cool video. Hopefully that kind of brings home. They mentioned that all of this food web is driven by the earth, and what we call that is chemosynthesis. So it's chemical synthesis instead of light synthesis, like photosynthesis, chemosynthesis. So it has to do with those chemicals from the hydrothermal vents that really drive this community and make this really unique community that is, well, we don't know much about, like you said, because we don't know much about them yet. But there are lots of areas that are now being studied because of ROVs and stuff, right?
Yeah, I mean, with 90% of the ocean, complete darkness, deep sea, I mean, not that much of it has been discovered.
So lots and lots for us to learn. So yeah, it is overall a very dark area. One of the other things that makes this kind of a tough environment in a deep sea in general to be around is that there's not a lot of food.
There isn't, no. And when you saw this last video, you saw those tube worms that were in that habitat. You're probably wondering, what do they eat? They're eating those chemicals that are coming out of the Earth's crust, which is the chemosynthesis.
Right. So yeah, really kind of unique, interesting there. It's mostly the soft bottom, which you can see in the picture here. That's normally what it looks like. There is sinking dead organisms and plankton that fall down to the bottom, and that does feed some of the animals. But overall, I mean, you can see that there's just not much down there. So it is this really, really harsh environment. There's also lots of challenges in finding mates. Low biomass of animals with a high diversity. So they're not going to. There's not a lot of each one, right?
There isn't. And of course, being completely dark, it'd be very hard to find those very few animals that are in this environment.
So lots of different types of animals, but not lots of each type of animals. Basically, what we mean with low biomass, but high density or diversity. I'm sorry, high diversity. And like you said, it's also really hard to explore down there, right? It's 90%, but hardly any of it. What is it? Less than 1% of the deep sea has been explored?
Yes.
That blows my mind.
Amazing.
Where does most of our information come from then if we're trying to learn about the deep seas?
Well, when you're in those ROVs, you're collecting organisms from those habitats, so those environments. So collecting those animals from these areas can definitely give us some insight on how they can live in those areas.
Tell me about ROVs. Like, I don't think we've talked about ROVs yet today, have we? No?
I don't think so.
No, what is an ROV?
What is it? It's just a remote operated vehicle. So kind of like a submarine, but the big ship that's above is actually operating this ship that's in the deep sea.
So some are manned. There are like manned submersibles where like someone is down there in the actual submersible looking around. And then some are unmanned. So they're just done strictly by controls up on the main mothership, essentially. And the aquarium goes live. And last summer, we actually talked to a lot of the researchers that were out there on the Okeanos that was deploying ROVs and taking samples and exploring parts of the ocean that nobody had been to before. And I believe they've been out recently. Isn't this season for them, like summertime?
I guess it depends on where they're going.
Yeah, but basically they have been exploring and doing these expeditions again, and you can watch live from home. I think it's explorenow.org. I'll try and find out.
That or even go to our website.
Yeah, or you go to our website. You can get to it from our website too. So really, really awesome. But yeah, so far it's been studied for only about 200 years. They've been starting to get into this deeper water. And as you were saying, there's lots of challenges too with collecting things and bringing them back to the surface. So that proposes its own challenge. Mm-hmm. All right, one of the last things that we're going to talk about today has to do with whale falls, which is one of the exhibits that we have at the aquarium that we were hoping to talk about a little bit, but we didn't get to see it. But real quick, Paris has a question. How is it that people can go to the moon and walk on its surface, but they can't walk on the bottom of the ocean? Paris, I totally agree with you. I don't know.
We should be doing that.
We can put a man on the moon, but we can't put a man in Marianas Trench, which is the deepest part of the world. Julia, is the collections of those animals by the ROVs one of the reasons that there are many species but very few of each of those species? No, they're not really collecting those animals, definitely not in high numbers, and bringing them back to the surface for studying. Just in general, it's a really harsh environment. It's not easy to find mates. They're really spread out because it's not like there's landmarks. I mean, we're talking about just imagine open desert that's miles and miles and miles long. I mean,
it's 90% of the world's ocean, so it's a pretty big area.
Right. So there's just spread out in these environments. There's not a lot of them. All right. So coming back to the whale falls, what we're going to talk about whale falls in a little bit more detail, but I want to show you this video of whale falls first that will give you an introduction to what they are and how cool they are. And then we'll kind of dive into the parts of a whale fall. So if we can go to our whale fall video, this is a little bit longer, but it's super cool.
Has been studying whale falls at different depths within the Monterey Canyon, which have revealed new insights about how these systems function. Dead whales that sink to the seafloor represent a massive pulse of energy to an otherwise nutrient-poor environment, and this feast in the deep can host diverse and abundant communities of organisms. When whales first arrive at the seafloor, flesh-devouring animals like hagfish, sharks, crabs, amphipods, polychaete worms, and rat-tail fish, seen here, strip soft tissue from bone. Once devoid of flesh, bacteria begin to colonize and, in turn, bacterial grazers and others come to feed on the concentration of food that the decomposing skeleton provides. Most of these organisms appear to be background taxa, organisms commonly found at the depth and habitat type where the whale fall occurs. However, at whale falls, they may occur in higher densities than normal, such as these brittle stars. Many new species have been found through this research, including these bone-devouring Ossidax worms, which specialize in digesting bone through the help of bacterial symbionts. Most animals aren't dependent upon whale carcasses for their survival, and even the Ossidax worms can utilize bones of other organisms and are not dependent upon whale bone for their survival. Surprisingly, this research showed that whale carcasses can degrade rapidly, depending on the size and age of the whale at death and the environmental conditions where the whale fall is located. We found that carcasses degraded in less than a decade, most likely due to the high abundance of Ossidax worms, which excavate the bones with root-like structures that bore into the bone, fragmenting and degrading it. 15 species of Ossidax have been found in Monterey Canyon, and they appear to occupy different niches. Some break down the laminated surface of bones, some bore deeply into bone, and still others feed on fragments of bone buried in the sediment. Several new species of bone-devouring snails have also been found at these whales and may contribute to this rapid degradation. Once the feast has ended, it's back to famine for these inhabitants of the deep.
All right, so that gives you an idea of what we're going to be talking about. Mm-hmm. So can you summarize for me real quick, what are we talking about when we say whale fall?
So you're probably wondering what happens when a whale dies. Well, it falls to the bottom of the ocean. And what's really neat is that these organisms that live in the deep sea, that's what they're relying on as food. So it's like a buffet that just came from the sky for them. And some of these organisms that are in the deep sea, they have a very slow metabolism because they're cold water, but also they don't need to eat as much. I mean, they can go months, years without eating. So that's why, I mean, having a lack of food, that's how they're able to adapt in that type of environment.
Yeah, and there's little known about whale falls. This is actually something new that was found when they started having submarines that were doing some mapping on the bottom. And they found these whale falls, and they're like, whoa, wait, what's going on here? Most of the food that these animals get on the bottom comes from marine snow, which is that dead plankton that we were talking about, other carcasses that kind of drizzle down. But when you get these whale falls, this is a huge, massive organism that comes to the bottom and provides food. I mean, these animals literally gorge themselves with what they can because it may be all they have. But the first one, actually, it wasn't submarine, I lied. It was an ROV, discovered the first one in 1977. That's not long ago at all.
Yeah.
So, that's why there's not much that's known. But what we do know is pretty amazing so far. University of Hawaii discovered more than 12,490 organisms on a whale, representing 43 different species of animal. So, pretty impressive for a whale fall. Now, because these whales we don't know where they are. We don't go, oh, here, there's the whale cemetery. Let's go head over there and see how it's happening. It doesn't work that way. We don't know when whales die or where they are when they die. And I surely doubt that they go to a whale hospital to die, you know, yeah. So it's not like we know where they are. And there have only been a few that have been discovered. And we have a whale map, a whale fall map, basically. I want to show you, if we can pull this full screen. These are the only ones, as far as I know, to date, that they know about so far. So can we pull this full screen, please? There we go. So this is Monterey Bay up here. So they've got Puppy, Grady, Francisco, and Pebbles. And they just nicknamed these whales. You can see in this big trench here. So this is all deep water right here. This is like a, you can kind of see the little areas there, but that's all deep water. And then we've got Shannon over here. That's way up, I think, off of Vancouver Island there. I know that there is another one in Southern California that was a man-made whale fall, meaning that there was a whale that washed up on shore and it had died. It was a carcass. And so they drug it out. They put a ton of weight on it and then they sunk it to the bottom. And then they wanted to study it and see what happened. Like, how long did it take for these different processes to happen? And it was just really interesting. So there are man-made whale falls, but how often do dead whales wash up on shore where, A, there's funding immediately available for this project, a staff ready to go. So it's really, really another tough environment to study. So let's talk about what they have found in these studies. Can you walk us through the stages of what happens when the whale... Now the carcass has sank to the bottom, and what happens next?
Once it sinks to the bottom of the ocean, there's a scavenger stage. And if you ever visit the Aquarium of the Pacific in our Wonders of the Deep Gallery, you'll see that's the mode that we're displaying there, where these crabs and different types of fish are actually scavenging on the tissue of the well.
And then, so that would be... the first part, right? They got to pull everything off the bones. That's about 90% of the tissue of the whale fall. So like big animals that you normally think of scavengers, right?
Yes.
All right. And then we have the enrichment opportunistic stage. What's that?
That's going to be where the marine worms and the crustaceans will take off any remains that's left on the well.
All right. And that's not the Osedax worms. Osedax worms are bone-burning
worms.
So these worms are like the ones that are kind of getting the nitty-gritty of the flesh.
That are...
like in the cracks and crevices of the bones and that kind of thing. Okay. And then so if the mass of the whale is sufficient or the whale falls deep enough... there's a sulfurphilic stage or sulfur-loving stage. Hydrogen sulfide-emitting bacteria are established and help to nourish the organisms. Mm-hmm. And then the sulfophilic phase, this could go into decades, right? I mean,
yes.
Just depending on what's available and what the conditions are. And then once it's basically, we're down to like the nitty-gritty of the bone, that's the last stage, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what's that? What happens there?
Basically, that's where the Osedax worms will secrete, release that acid, and that will break down the bone.
So there's like they mentioned there's 15 different species of those Osedax worms. One is kind of like the burrowing into the bone, and then there's other ones that go for like the other pieces, and then there's the ones that even get the bone fragments in the sand that are left over from the other Osedax worms. So it's like... literally, every single piece of this whale fall is used and will feed thousands of animals for potentially years, like you said, that's their only food source. And we've always had these questions like, how do the animals know to get to the whale fall? I mean, there's so much we don't know about this whole ecosystem. It just blows my mind.
And it's amazing because those Osedax worms, they don't even have a mouth or a gut. So how do they absorb their food, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah, and then they were talking about like how all those brittle stars came in the video, like over to the whale fall. Oh my gosh, it's crazy. Mm-hmm. Like, because remember when we looked at that one picture where it was just the bare bottom, there's like nothing there. And then you get a whale fall and it's it reminds me of that scene from Ace Ventura when he walks into his apartment. And he opens up like I don't know if you guys have seen that, maybe I've just totally dated myself. But then there's that scene where he walks into his apartment and he's like, oh, and all the animals start flocking to him.
Now I need to watch the movie tonight.
You haven't watched Ace Ventura, there are definitely some funny scenes.
There you go.
All right, this is from, I think, Av. or Ave, what is the most common death reason for the fallen whales? Good question. I don't know if anybody knows that. Could be old age, could be attacked by an orca. For example, orcas don't take everything. They only eat chunks of it. Could be ship strike. They were hit by boats or ships. Could just be they were sick. Who knows? It could have to do with Navy sonar in some cases. I don't know if there's necessarily a main reason other than whales die. So, all right. So that's kind of one of the really cool environments down there, those whale falls. One of the last things that we're going to finish up with our last 5-6 minutes of class is fish adaptations. And I'm going to jump forward a little bit. We'll come back and hit these other ones, DM, because I want to get to this last video of bioluminescence, which is essentially living light. Right? So can you talk, just real quick, introduce us to what bioluminescence is, and then we're going to watch this video, and then with the last couple of minutes, we'll go through the other things.
So with being dark sea, you definitely need something to attract mates or even to locate food. So animals have bioluminescence, and that could be an organism that harbors bacteria in a certain organ, and that bacteria will emit a light to, of course, attract prey for that fish or that living host. So in a deep sea environment, this is very important for an animal to have.
And in some cases, like you said, it's a bacteria that does the light. Other cases, I guess there are animals that do produce their own light too.
Yes.
Or like a firefly, mm-hmm. For example, is an insect that does, but there are others that are like fish that will produce their own light too. So this woman, this is a TED talk where she went down to deep sea and saw this bioluminescent organisms, both like plankton, and I think there's fish in there too. Really cool video. It's about 3 minutes. I want to get to this right away so we can watch it all, and then we'll wrap up with another few cool adaptations that these deep sea fish have. So let's go straight to that video, please.
I love most in the ocean. And that's the incredible number and variety of animals in it that make light. My addiction began with this strange-looking diving suit called WASP. That's not an acronym, just somebody thought it looked like the insect. It was actually developed for use by the offshore oil industry for diving on oil rigs down to a depth of 2,000 feet. Right after I completed my PhD, I was lucky enough to be included with a group of scientists that were using it for the first time as a tool for ocean exploration. We trained in a tank in Port Hueneme, and then my first open ocean dive was in the Santa Barbara Channel. It was an evening dive. I went down to a depth of 880 feet and turned out the lights. And the reason I turned out the lights is because I knew I would see this phenomenon of animals making light called bioluminescence. But I was totally unprepared for how much there was and how spectacular it was. I saw chains of jellyfish called siphonophores that were longer than this room, pumping out so much light that I could read the dials and gauges inside the suit without a flashlight. And puffs and billows of what looked like luminous blue smoke, and explosions of sparks that would swirl up out of the thrusters, just like when you throw a log on a campfire and the embers swirl up off the campfire, but these were icy blue embers. It was breathtaking. Now, usually if people are familiar with bioluminescence at all, it's these guys, fireflies, and there are a few other land dwellers that can make light, some insects, earthworms, fungi. But in general, on land, it's really rare. In the ocean, it's the rule rather than the exception. If I go out in the open ocean environment, virtually anywhere in the world, and I drag a net from 3,000 feet to the surface, most of the animals, in fact, in many places, 80 to 90% of the animals that I bring up in that net make light. This makes for some pretty spectacular light shows. Now, I want to share with you a little bit of video that I've shot from a submersible. I first developed this technique working from a little single-person submersible called Deep Rover, and then adapted it for use on the Johnson Sea Link, which you see here. So, mounted in front of the observation sphere, there's a 3-foot diameter hoop with a screen stretched across it, and inside the sphere with me is an intensified camera that's about as sensitive as the fully dark adapted human eye, albeit a little bit fuzzy. So you turn on the camera, turn out the lights. That sparkle you're seeing is not luminescence, that's just electronic noise on these super intensified cameras. You don't see luminescence until the submersible begins to move forward through the water, but as it does, animals bumping into the screen are stimulated to bioluminesce. Now, when I was first doing this, all I was trying to do was count the numbers of sources. I knew my forward speed, I knew the area, and so I could figure out how many hundreds of sources there were per cubic meter. But I started to realize that I could actually identify animals by the type of flashes they produced. And so here.
So really awesome to just see that bioluminescence. She said she was only down about 800 feet. So again, that's just the top portion. We're talking about deep sea, really far, but just to give you a really cool idea of what that bioluminescence looks like. So that's something, like Deanne said, that's going to help them find mates, avoid predators, look up the flashlight fish, which we have at the aquarium. That's a perfect example of an animal that can avoid predation in these dark seas by using bioluminescence. So this guy behind us here, this is an angler fish. This is an adaptation for an animal that lives in the deep sea because of their mouth and their little light, right? Tell me about that.
So if you look at this angler fish, you see that it has that hinged mouth, also those large teeth, and that can be used to quickly grab prey. And then also you have your angler, which above on the top you have that light, where it's emitting light. And so if this fish would be hungry, all it'd have to do is just wiggle that angler, and another prey would see that, and they will be wondering, what is that? And they'll come closer, and there you go.
And look at how that mouth is angled perfectly up to catch anything that's interested in that light.
That's amazing.
So that's one of the adaptations that these animals will have, these huge mouths and large, sharp teeth. There's the lack of food. About 5% from the surface makes it to the deep sea. So these animals, when there's food available, they've got to be on it. And so they're going to be animals with these huge mouths. I'll take whatever I can get kind of ideas. Real quick, before we move on, Jennifer had a question. How long do whales live? Totally depends on the whale. Anywhere probably from 20 years to some of the dolphins, up to over 100 years, and even estimated into 200 years for bowhead whales. So, well, on average, probably between 50 and 100 years, I would say. But there are some extremes, right, like the bowhead whales. All right, so we saw about those hinged mouths and the huge mouths with large sharp teeth. Some of them have large sensitive eyes. That's going to be ones that are trying to pick up any bits of light that they can.
Like right? The blue shark that we saw earlier.
Like the blue shark that's going to have those huge eyes. Mm-hmm. But some animals, such as the hagfish, right, they don't have any eyes.
They don't
right?
have any eyes, and they actually have light spots. So they can determine some light, but they don't have developed eyes. So they're more like just eye spots.
Yeah, so really kind of just interesting. And they don't really totally understand why there's no eye spots either, right? I mean why there's no eyes. Like, they're able to make it. I guess without light, it doesn't really matter if you have
think,
eyes.
Yeah, if you're living in the deep sea, why would you need eyes?
Absolutely, yeah. Makes sense. So, all right, with that, we are done for today. Deanne, thank you so much for coming
to chat with us today.
And don't forget, the quiz will open up as soon as our class closes or finishes up. Discussion boards are due every week. Those are worth 4 points. Make sure you're citing a source, you're creating your own thread, and responding to someone else's thread. During the week, if you have any questions, please make sure and email me. I do check that email every single day, bio190@lbaop.org. Make sure you're working on your field trip paper, research proposal, and that extra credit lab will be due soon too. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, I will see you next week.